It's Rupert Sutton, research fellow at the Henry Jackson Society. Thank you so much, Rupert, for being patient with us. Just quickly tell everybody about the Henry Jackson Society.
Well, the Henry Jackson Society is a policy think tank which looks to study extremism and terrorism, really to work out what's happening in the world, what we can do to challenge extremism, how government can best respond to the threats that we see and protect its people.
Well, you're uniquely well placed then to talk to Andreas, who you might have heard before we went to Billy on travel there. Who said the response that we've heard thus far from François Hollande, you know, noble and fantastic and fighting and belligerent though it may be, it highlights the problem, the alienation from us, a sense of belonging, a sense of being a victim, and the very things that work towards radicalizing these young people in the first place. What say you to that?
Well, I think that in response to attacks like this, and I mean, in this case, we don't know for certain whether or not there is any connection to Syria, though it does fit the pattern of similar attacks that have been suggested by both Islamic State, actually, and Al-Qaeda officials in the past. But I think what governments need to think about is how actually can they stop people from getting to the stage where they're going to carry out an attack like this in the first place. So putting policies in place that help people identify people at risk of radicalization. But I think also it is important that we reduce the ability of extremist groups to operate. So reducing their ability to train individuals in places like Syria, reducing their ability to plan attacks without any response from Western governments. So I do think we have to kind of take those almost as a kind of two-pronged approach. How can we work with people in the UK or in France whilst also damaging the ability of extremists?
Well, there you go. You know, people at risk of being radicalized, almost anybody who's been to jail or a petty criminal then. So what do you do? Target all Muslims? How would you do that?
No, certainly not. I think one of the main things to point out is that the risks of radicalization cover all different ideologies. But you mentioned petty crime, and actually in our research, one of the things that's come up in a significant number of biographies of individuals who go on to become involved in violent extremism is a history of petty crime, is a history of coming into contact with the authorities. Now, in the UK, we currently have policy to help people who might come across people either arrested, convicted of offences, help them identify those who might be vulnerable to being radicalised, might show the signs that they're falling in with a group that's seeking to recruit them, or potentially show them the signs that they might be living in a toxic home environment where they're unable to get a job or they found finding housing very difficult. And what we seek to do in this country is provide that wide-ranging, multi-agency support that can help those people. And I think that's something that the French should be looking at, particularly given the amount of attacks they're seeing at the moment.
Yeah, let's bring it to the UK. We know that the new Prime Minister was a Home Secretary. You know, we know what we called conveniently the Snoopers Charter was something that she was quite fond of, and there was some kickback, wasn't there, originally from the Liberal Democrats in coalition. Are we waiting for the moment when that comes up again?
Well, I think it is important that the security services have the ability to identify particularly extremist kind of chatter, I suppose, on social media and online. One thing we've seen in the UK, for example, very recently, a number of individuals convicted of planning a shooting attack in West London were surveilled whilst downloading a program which enabled them to talk essentially encrypted with one another. So they were able to talk to each other and potentially to talk to people in Syria through an encrypted messaging app. So it's clear that security services do need the powers that will help them challenge that. But wider than kind of spying on people or snooping, as you mentioned, it's I think important that people realise actually one of the main ways to challenge radicalisation is simply being aware of the signs that people might show as they slip down that pathway, as they develop the intent to harm others and the intent to become involved with groups that could potentially drive them to attacks. So it's important that teachers, police officers, anyone who might work in public sector is able to see those signs and to feel comfortable identifying people who might be at risk.
Yeah, just before you leave us, what are the signs?
Well, this is the I suppose the most difficult part of this this problem is that there are many different signs for people, but one of the main things to keep an eye out for is So when people are becoming more withdrawn, when they're starting to express support for prescribed organisations, if they start to become involved with groups which might not be illegal but are spreading extremist views, so a number of signs here. And what's important is that we give people the confidence to see when they see something like that, to say, look, this isn't going to see somebody criminalised. They're not going to be arrested. But what we can do is alert local social services, alert local pastoral care providers who might be able to provide the best help possible to stop people not just harming others, but also ruining their own lives in the process.
Thank you so much. Appreciate your time very much. Rupert Sutton there from the Henry Jackson Society.